Amen?
Amen.
Listen, we're glad you're here and come to have some church tonight. Looking forward to this evening's service. Brother Bill, begin our service, please. Amen. Amen. All right. Boy, what a weather change, huh? I tell you. Here's what's going on. Saturday, we do have a little business right after the service tonight. Saturday, a trip to Lambert's. Looks like a pretty good crew has signed up for that. If you're going, sign the list out there. If you're riding the bus, put that off to the side, or if you're going to drive. But it ought to be a good day. Bus is leaving at 9:30 sharp, okay? But that's this Saturday. Other than that, just got a lot of folks on our prayer list. We're going to go down the list tonight, and it's long. And many folks we need to be praying for this evening. We do want to remember Brother Ron, Ronnie's daughter, Kaylin. A lot of you got the message that she had a house fire, lost everything. And so we're going to be taking a special offering Sunday morning. We'll have our regular tithes and offering. And then kind of like when we have a singing, we'll take a second offering. We'll take a second offering for those that would like to help out with that. So you'll have an opportunity to do something to be a blessing to them, okay? We want to remember Sister Charlene and Gerald. I talked to Gerald just a little while ago, and it's just steadily not doing well at all. She'll pretty well be bedridden from tomorrow on, it looks like. Not able to really get up for anything. But hold her up in prayer. They both really need our prayers. Laura and Ronnie, remember both of them. As you pray this evening, she's not feeling real good tonight, so hold up Laura in prayer. Diana and Stanley, want to hold them up in prayer. Robert Stubbs, Linda Teasley, Brother James Teasley, Cindy Watson, Lana, Lowell Fox, Yvonne, Larry Baker, David Pinkley. Yes? I don't know. You must have looked kind of puny one day. I don't really recall.
I think I'm doing about as well.
Okay. So I'll take you off. Grace, Marilyn Kelly, throat cancer, Jean Young, Jean Dotson. And she should have come home from the hospital today. Should be home now. And really had some serious blood pressure issues going on. Hold her up in prayer. Sister Doris, Vera, Mabel, Mary Logan, Ketta Plank, Betty Bowman, cancer, Bob St. Jim, Lyndall Richardson, Ken Bailey, Bob Gibson in bereavement, Robert Inman, cancer, Charmaine, that's Colette's sister, cancer, Little Georgia, and Jean Jinkerson. Remember all of these as you pray tonight. I may have missed somebody, but that's a lot of names. Help me out. Is there someone else you'd like to mention? Bill. I did. Yeah, remember Mary Logan, yeah. Okay, remember Becky.
How's David doing?
Sister Alta, remember her in prayer tonight, okay? I talked with her last night, and she was doing a little better. Anyone else you'd like to mention?
I'm telling you that Georgia came through surgery okay and doing pretty good. And then for Jean Jinkerson, dying grace.
Yeah.
She's.
Yeah. Right. Remember all these. A lot of needs tonight.
Thank you, sir.
Roberta Inman?
Yeah.
I've got her. Yes. Yeah. Remember all these folks as we... Is there somebody else you'd like to mention? Okay. Remember all these as we pray. And if the Lord tarries, we're praying for another good day at church Sunday.
Amen.
And the Lord to really, really bless. Okay. God bless you. Good being in church tonight. Brother James, why don't you just sing right where you're sitting and we'll be good. We'll do good.
692 if you want to use the hymnal.
Won't it be wonderful there?
Well, the chiropractor hasn't made a believer out of me yet, so. But it's just been two visits, so we'll see. At last, if I recall the count, ladies, it's 189 to 112. Huh? No, we're getting farther. We finally broke $100, but we're getting farther behind. All right, an old song I like to sing from time to time. Go ahead, Brother Matt. I have journeyed through the long, dark night. Out on the open sea, by faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storms. Well, I've had visions, and I've had dreams, and I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew that they would slip right through, like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the ship
is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have been young, but I am older now, and there has been beauty that these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life, oh, that's where God proved His love for me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm.
Friend, don't worry about the heavy load I carry. Don't be concerned if it sends me to my knees. For I know a place where all my load will lighten, and I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. If my feeble hand of faith can only reach out through this dark and dreary storm of unbelief, and if He'll slip His nail-scarred hand into my hand, I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. Thank you. soon now I will reach the hill Golgotha. I'll touch the cross fashioned from a tree. And if just one precious drop of his blood touches me, I'll be all right because I've touched Calvary. If my feeble hand of faith can only reach out through this dark and dreary storm of unbelief, and if he'll slip his nail-scarred hand into my hand, I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. Brother Rich, come preach to us.
Good to be in the Lord's house tonight.
Yes.
I'm going to finish up tonight what we started Sunday night. 10 rules of life that kind of help us through our problems. And I'll tell you what, I find it helps you whether you're in a problem or not in a problem, it's still good to live by.
Amen.
And it's helped me. I had a couple comments Sunday night, that some people's going through some things and seemed to help them a little bit. And that was the first five. We're going to go through the second five tonight. They won't take, I don't think, as long as the first. So I know we got a business meeting tonight, but these rules are called the Red Sea rules. Number one was when you find yourself in a tough place, recognize that God has either put you there or allowed you to be there in that situation for some reason, known only for now, perhaps to himself only. Sometimes God puts us in there and we're wondering what's going on, but he's put us there for a reason, folks. And number one, to get the glory out of it. He was getting glory over Egypt and Pharaoh. Number two was be more concerned for God's glory than for your own welfare and your own relief. Number three, acknowledge your enemy and keep your eyes on Christ. Buddy, we need to do that. Because
yes.
We have a lot of enemies floating around out there, and we need to know our enemy. And I'm afraid there's a lot of people today that do not. Number four was pray. You can't beat prayer, folks. You can't beat prayer. And number five, don't be afraid. Stay calm and confident and give the Lord time to work. He works in his time and his way, and not in our time and way. So we just have to trust him. That's the key of this, is trusting the Lord. In Exodus 14, and in verse 19 is where we pick up with the sixth rule. It says, when you don't know what to do, just do what comes next. The next logical step by faith. In 14 verse 19 says, the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them, and a pillar of a cloud was before their face and stood behind them. And it came between them and the camp of Egypt and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them. It was a cloud of darkness to them. But it gave light by night to these, so that they, one came not near to the other, all night. Father, as we come to you tonight, as we open your word, we pray, Lord, as we look into it, that you might touch our hearts and help us, Lord, to grow, be closer to you, put our trust and our faith in you no matter what happens, in days of darkness and days of light. Help us, Lord, to always put you first. Give you the glory and honor for all things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
What we see here is they stand at the sea. As the wind starts to blow and they see the water start to part. Now I know you've all seen Moses in the Ten Commandments? Is that what it did? He holds his rod out and boy, man, the water starts going back. I don't know how it happened. I don't know whether it happened like that. It's nice to think of it happened like that. But you know what the important thing is? It happened. And they stood there and they watched in awe. As the wind started to blow and the water started to recede, it said it blew all night long. So I kind of, in my mind, and what the scripture says, I don't really go along with the big, you know, all at once like the movie. There's an old man, Bible commentator, C.H. McIntosh. He had an interesting theory on this. And sometimes I think that's probably closer to the real truth. He believed that the Red Sea did not roll back all at one time, like what we've seen in the Ten Commandments. That once the wind started to blow, the sea started to roll back slowly. And as the children of Israel moved forward by faith, and believe me, they had to move forward by faith. Now, no doubt in my mind that they seen water on each side of it. But it says, as they moved forward by faith, the more they went forward, the more the water receded in front of them, taking step by step. Now, when God rolled the water back, says they went on dry land. He could blow the water out of a mud puddle and make it dry if he wants to. He blew the water out of the Red Sea and made it dry. And I believe it was an all-night thing according to the scripture. It said the wind blew all night. And nevertheless, how it happened, God guides us in the right time. That we have to have faith to take those steps whenever he opens the door for us. You must move forward one step at a time. And God will give light and guidance. That's what he did. He gave them light to go. The thing is to keep our heart in a state of dependence on the Lord. We just move step by step, day by day. You know, when Paul was wanting to go to Asia to minister, doors kept closing on him. But Paul didn't give up. Paul just looked around and watched for one of those doors to open up a step at a time. And that's what he did. And as he moved forward, as the doors opened for him, he began to evangelize Asia Minor. Just take the next logical step. And that makes it a lot easier. Moment by moment, step by step, he leads us when we need to go and where we need to go.
Amen.
We just have to trust him, trust God. Then in rule number 7, envisions God enveloping presence. You know, they had the cloud during the day and the pillar of fire by night to guide them. Well, in verse 19, the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went from behind, and then the pillar of the cloud went before their face and stood behind them, between them and the nation of Egypt. They couldn't see Egypt. Egypt couldn't see them because of the pillar, a cloud. The fire went before them to light their way. God always lights our way. He said, he talked about the angel here. He said, the angel of the Lord. You know, this is a perfect description of the Lord Jesus Christ. It really is. You know, several times during the scripture, we're given a picture of the angel of the Lord. And I believe it's none other than Jesus himself. He didn't manifest himself in a way that they could recognize him, but they sure could recognize the power through the cloud and through the fire. Children of Israel, he gave them protection. He gave them guidance. He gives them light, and he gives us light today. Hey, he is the Word. He is the light. He is the light of the world. Outside of him is darkness. What's darkness? Darkness is sin. In Revelation chapter 1, we get another vision of him too. It has to do with the church. You know, things are a little bit different than today than it was in the day of Pentecost. Before the day of Pentecost, the church. He dealt with the Old Testament people a little different than he does today. He dealt with them more directly on a God-man basis. Just like he did here. You know, we don't see a pillar of fire, a pillar of cloud this day and time, do we? But from the day of Pentecost on, he deals through the Holy Spirit. He's still there, just like he was, only he deals with us through his blessed Holy Spirit. In Revelation chapter 1, we see him. He says, and I turned, and John speaking, he says, I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and behold, turning, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his foot, and girt about with paps with a golden girdle. Who is that standing among the candlesticks? None other than Jesus himself. He stands in the church today. He leads and guides us just like he did the nation of Israel through the fire and through the cloud. He protects them. He stands amongst the church today, dealing with us through his Holy Spirit. You know, Israel saw the presence in the wilderness. We saw the Shekinah glory, the presence in the old temple. When they went into the Holy Holies, what did they see? They seen the Shekinah glory of God. On the day of Pentecost, he manifested himself like cloven tongues. And from that time on, he began to deal with man through his Holy Spirit. We can feel that Spirit today. Just as strong as they saw it, we can feel the Holy Spirit. Amen. We just have to listen. We just have to watch. Rule number 8. Trust God to save and deliver in his own unique way. That's his specialty. He don't do things like, he said, my ways are not your ways. In 21, verse 21, it says, and Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all night. I think it took all night to get this done, but he paved the way. Now, as the sea rolled back, were the children of Israel following the light of God and going across? Does it roll back, or did it all? We don't know. We're not told. We're just told that it took all night. And even if he rolled it back all at one time, it's still going to take a while to get 2 or 3 million people through there.
Yeah.
And he may roll it back at night, and they went across the next day. We're really not told. We're just told that he did. It says, and the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon dry ground, and the waters were a wall to them on their right and on their left. So we know that it wasn't ankle-deep water that blew back, was it? And then I kind of get a picture of the Ten Commandments when the water rolled back and how it did. It'd be quite a sight. The people just stood there kind of slack-jawed looking at it. And God told them to move. The water started to roll back. The dry ground appeared. Does God still do things like that today? Well, I haven't heard of him rolling the sea back for a while. Could he? He absolutely could. A lot of it depends on our faith. I've seen him do things that I thought, man, only God could do that. Yes, he still works, just like he did then. Maybe in a little bit different way, but he still works. Does he protect people? Absolutely. Does he heal? Absolutely. Does he protect us, his people, fulfill their needs? Absolutely. Number 9. If you review your current crisis as a faith builder for the future, look at Exodus 30 or 14, 30 and 31. The Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore, and Israel saw a great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord. And what did they do? They believed. They believed the Lord and his servant Moses. After all their belly aching, whining, and complaining, they finally got it. You know what? As a nation, they're still as lost as a goose. They're still living in the Old Testament time. But we don't know why God allows problems, but we do know that he intends to use them to heighten our faith, mature us, and deepen our faith. Trials and troubles, you know what they are? They're just like dumbbells and treadmills to our soul. They're to strengthen us and to help us have the stamina to go through them. You know, not too many years ago, there was a gunman walked into Fort Worth Baptist Church one night when they was having a youth service. And I read this and I thought, man, that's, he said, the little girl, this 14-year-old girl was one of them that was killed, and her name was Casey Griffin. Her parents said that she loved frogs, said she collected frogs. Collected figurines, trinkets, jewelry. Said you could summarize her philosophy: fully rely on God. Frog. Said fully rely on God. I thought, man, that's neat. Hey, we need to be frog Christians. You know that? We really do. You know, we had a lot of Old Testament saints that relied on God. Mary, angel come to her and told her what he told her. She was going to bear our Savior. Hey, she just relied on God. The old Apostle Paul, all he went through, he trusted God, relied on him. So many relied on God back then. I hope we can. I hope you rely on God and trust him. And like I said, I just thought that was a neat little thing, is to be a frog Christian. Number 10. Don't forget to praise him. Man, I think sometimes we forget to praise him, or we praise him in the wrong way. Exodus 15. Then almost the entire chapter 15 says, Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. And horses and their riders hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. He is my God. I will prepare him a habitation. My Father God, and I will exalt him. And you go ahead and you can read the rest of that chapter, and it's a song. It's a song of praise unto the Lord. Imagine, after they got across, I think they were stunned. And I think they were in shock until they got to the other side. I believe they stood there in silence, wondering what just happened. Now the terror was over. It was behind them. God delivered them. The enemy was gone, no sign except for a few bodies laying on the shore. The night was over, a new day. I'm sure, like I said, it was quiet for a while, and then a little buzz started. Then someone like old Herbie shouted out, praise the Lord. Then they began to shout and praise God, singing to him. Like I said, chapter 15 is just a prayer. God loves his people to praise him. We need to be in a mind and a state of praise all the time. Our lives should be a praise unto him. Now I know on this day and time, some of the things that are saying in the church and the way that they do it, I don't believe God's in it. I don't believe God's pleased with some of it. But he's pleased whenever we are touched and we give him the glory and the honor and praise his name. You know what we can do in the morning when we get up before we have our toast and our bacon? Praise the Lord. Give him praise for that day. Live a life of praise. Rob Morgan's got a little book of songs called Then Sings My Soul. He's got two or three of them. I've got some of them. And he gives, it's like a hymn book. On each hymn, he gives a story of how and why those songs were written. Man, there's some great testimonies. I get blessed by reading that. Some of the things that people went through and were delivered and then wrote our gospel hymns. Sometimes God's got to put us in a spot where he gets our attention, doesn't he? But you know what? He always brings us out. And if he doesn't, it's better on the other side. It's better on the other side. Father, as we come to you this morning, or tonight, Lord, we're thankful, Lord, for your love and all you've done for us. We're thankful, Lord, for this word, this chapter. Lord, there's so much in it for us to live by. We need to draw closer to you. Number one, put our trust and our faith in you. let you lead and guide us, and then give you the praise for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.